NASA's HLS program chose SpaceX as its private partner for developing a spacecraft capable of returning astronauts to the moon for its Artemis program. Despite plenty of drama surrounding NASA's decision, SpaceX has emerged as the space agency's de facto collaborator, receiving billions in funding to turn its super heavy-lift Starship into a lunar lander. But Artemis 3, NASA's first planned crewed mission to the lunar surface, is still a long way out. And while SpaceX has made strides in developing Starship, it has yet to successfully launch it or its accompanying super heavy booster to orbit. During the upcoming uncrewed mission, NASA and SpaceX may choose to take along, potentially one payload, according to Watson Morgan, landing near the south pole of the moon. Artemis 3, however, will be far more involved. For one, there's the size of the Starship itself. Astronauts will have a very unique perspective, once the 165-feet-tall spacecraft lands upright on the surface. That also means getting in and out will prove a lot more difficult than simply climbing up and down the ladder, attached to the outside of Apollo-era lunar landers. SpaceX has been working on an exterior elevator that take crews down to the surface. The company already built a full-scale mock-up of the system, allowing astronauts to test it out while wearing simulated spacesuits. It's a very tall lander, Watson Morgan said during this week's meeting. It doesn't look like the traditional landers that we've all seen in the past, so it can be hard to reconcile that mentally. SpaceX is busy testing Starship and prototyping hardware and most recently built and demonstrated an elevator, in a very short period of time. For its lunar lander design, SpaceX has pitched a variation on its Starship spacecraft. SpaceX is already on its 15th Starship prototype and has been regularly testing the craft. Many of the prototypes have so far crashed and exploded, with SN10, its 10th Starship prototype being the first to land, though it exploded shortly after landing. Just from the human landing system standpoint, we had 27 functional performance requirements that we asked the offers, including SpaceX. And we went through a very detailed design, technical design, construction standards, safety, as well as health and human performance work, and all of that was pulled together, and that shifted various aspects of their Starship. They were able to meet or exceed the items that we had that we require for safe human landing. Known as the Human Landing System, HLS program, NASA selected three providers, a Blue Origin-led consortium, Dynetics, and SpaceX, to build prototypes and compete for one or two follow-on contracts back in April 2020. SpaceX's Starship offering was deemed the riskiest solution, and the company received a middling $135 million, to Dynetics' $250 million and the national team's $570 million. For their $820 million investment, it's unclear what exactly NASA has gotten from its two best-funded teams, aside from paperwork. A few completed design reviews, and two low-fidelity mock-ups mostly made out of cardboard, foam, and wood. Meanwhile, in the 10 months since SpaceX received its $135 million, the company has built no less than 8 full-scale Starship prototypes. Performed a dozen or more wet dress rehearsals and static fires with said prototypes, and performed 2 powered hops and 4 high altitude test flights. Now, to add to that list of low cost achievements, SpaceX has also built and tested a functioning prototype of the elevator Starship would use to lift and lower astronauts to and from the lunar surface. SpaceX's proposal is certainly a unique one, with Starship being no less than several times taller and heavier than both its prospective competitors. However, Blue Origin's extraordinarily complex 3-stage, 4-component lander, requiring a separate transfer stage, descent stage, ascent stage, and crew cabin, makes even Starship seem somewhat reasonable. Notably, that massive 8-to-10-meter stack of separate spacecraft, crew cabin at the peak, would force NASA astronauts to transit a several-story ladder to and from the lunar surface. Far taller than the Apollo program's lander ladder, which NASA was already somewhat tepid on at the time. Navigating a tall ladder in a clumsy, imprecise lunar EVA spacesuit would be extremely challenging and relatively risky. Dynetics is by far the least concerning solution in that regard, requiring what amounts to a footstool relative to SpaceX and Blue Origin. In the national team's defense, SpaceX's elevator approach is also undeniably risky, and it's safe to say that demonstrated reliability would be an absolute necessity for NASA to ever accept that solution. Of course, SpaceX could feasibly include a hand-cranked backup system, and a ladder on Starship's exterior in the event of total system failure. But both backups would still pose risks similar to or greater than the national team's ladder. However, the fact that SpaceX has already built and begun testing a Starship moon elevator prototype makes it hard to believe that the company couldn't ultimately produce a safe, reliable, redundant elevator between now and the mid to late 2020s. On a separate note, it's unclear when or where SpaceX built and tested the first Starship elevator. The photo NASA's Mark Karasich provider appears to show an elevator prototype situated inside a steel Starship ring, with the sky visible. But nothing like that setup has been spotted at SpaceX's Boca Chica Starship factory, or former Florida production facilities. That leaves its Hawthorne, California factory or, perhaps, a mysterious, Roberts Road, facility on Kennedy Space Center land. Either way, it certainly appears that SpaceX has yet to show all its cards, and is doing everything it can to convince NASA that Starship is worth additional HLS contracts. NASA award contracts for full up moon lander demonstrations to SpaceX. SpaceX's newly announced moon Starship is a fairly radical departure from the Mars-focused, fully reusable vehicle the company has been pursuing for years. Unintuitively, that may be the perfect half-step towards truly reusable Mars rockets. On April 30, NASA announced that SpaceX had won $135 million to design and build a highly customized variant of its reusable Starship spacecraft. With the intention of launching a handful of space agency astronauts to the moon in the mid-2020s. Whether or not that initial seed translates into enough funding to seriously design and build the ship SpaceX has shown off in new renders. It has already broken the ice, so to speak, between the US federal government or at least NASA, and the company's ambitious next-generation launch vehicle. With a substantial amount of money now on the table for SpaceX to begin initial work on its moon Starship. It's worth analyzing just how different it is from the Starship the company is working on today. First and foremost, perhaps the most obvious difference between SpaceX's base Starship and its lunar variant is the rocket's hull. In the case of the moonbound ship, SpaceX appears to have scrapped to a fully painted vehicle for unknown reasons. More likely than not, that white paint is likely motivated by the fact that proposed NASA moon landers must obviously be capable of landing and safely returning their astronaut cargo back into lunar orbit. To do that, those landers must be able to sit on the surface of the moon after landing for at least several days, with longer stays being even better. NASA and SpaceX have their work cut out for them. For instance, SpaceX is still figuring out how many Starship spacecraft it will have to launch into orbit to actually get to the moon. The company is envisioning the spacecraft to also serve as a mobile fuel tank, providing a place for other Starship to refuel in orbit before headed to Moontown. Last year, SpaceX CEO Elon Musk wagered a guess, estimating that it will take max of 8 Starships worth of fuel to get to the moon and back. And then there's still the considerable task of safely getting humans down to surface, back into the spacecraft, and safely launch back into orbit, a gargantuan task in and of itself. Thanks for watching this video and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, to make sure you can subscribe. If you have any crazy idea what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we will see if we can get the, and thanks again for watching and goodbye.